Well, Bob, I mean, I've always liked Devo to a certain extent, but the more I hear them, the more the years go by, you just realise how original and how fresh they were. It just still sounds so great, doesn't it?
Absolutely wonderful, because we're looking at Melody Maker 1978, and you think, hearing that in 78, you know? Like I say, it's a real shock to the senses, and there's loads of Devo in this. Actually, before we get to it, I know we do music papers from across the decades here. The 60s tend to be slight, don't they? But they're interesting because they've got the present the long view of history in hindsight. But the 70s is where the real meat is. And this Melody Maker, this is 25th of February 1978. This has got 80 pages in it. There's loads. It's huge.
Yeah, mate, but...
Oh, go on, what are you going
to
say now?
But I would have to say probably 40 of them are bass guitars, amplifiers, guitar pedal. I mean, it's a massive music. It was a the thing about Melody Maker was it was a real kind of musos paper, wasn't it?
Yeah,
and it was always a bit more serious in the end.
It was, so yeah.
And people used to always advertise for musicians in that. So famously, that would be the go-to for bands like Genesis or whoever, you know, seeks keyboard
Roxy
player.
Music and all that stuff. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there is a lot of that. So front page here, you've got David Bowie returns to Britain in mid-June for a series of shows in London, Newcastle, Glasgow and Stafford, part of a larger American and European tour that takes him to 65 cities. His band includes two veterans from the group with which he played the Empire Pool. That had been in 76. You went to that, didn't you?
Yep.
Dennis Davis, drums, percussion, George Murray, bass. We're joined by Stacey Hayden, guitar, former Hawkwind vocal, violinist Simon House, Sean Mays of Fumble on keyboards, and Roger Powell from Utopia, right across the board there. So it's kind of a proggy background.
And David Hemmings, he famously followed Bowie around on that tour and filmed it, but I don't think Bowie liked it.
No.
It never came out, did he? But I believe there are clips of it in the new Moon Age Daydream film.
Oh, are there? I was going to wondering what happened to that. Yeah, so we know that Hemmings filmed it, and there is footage of that entire show somewhere.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Bowie protégés Devo, we've just heard, who Bowie is helping Brian Eno producing Cologne, are scheduled to play a one-off date at London's Roundhouse. Devo have come from Akron, Ohio, been together for 5 years, have attracted considerable interest in recent months with their absurdist philosophy of devolution and music they describe as 80s industrial rock and roll. Competition for their signatures amongst record companies has been hot, but the maker understands they'll sign with WEA in the next fortnight. In Britain, Island, Bronze, Virgin and Stiff are all interested, but Stiff has agreed an independent deal for 3 singles.
Great story behind them. I mean, we looked at them, I think it was for the A to Z of David Bowie.
Yeah.
And just a really interesting story how they got together. I think it was at university, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But that was around about 19... Was it late 60s? Did they start the formulate in the late 60s?
I think it was, maybe 69, definitely 70, because they were all at Kent State, I think, weren't they?
That's right, yeah. It's a really interesting story. Yeah. You just want to go and chase it.
Yeah, wonderful. More of them later on. In the meantime, in the news page, got Derek Jarman's Jubilee. It's the cinema's first serious attempt to assimilate punk. Independently produced and made entirely in Britain. It features music by Eno, Adam and the Ants and Wayne County, amongst others, and gives sizable parts to Jordan and Adamant, as well as cameo roles to The Slits, County and Gene October. But the music, it says, is almost unimportant in the movie, apart from, admittedly, an impressive sequence where Jordan mimes to an outre version of Rule Britannia. Jarman is far more concerned with his own ill-conceived ideas about punk attitudes. He said, "Punk seems to be a genuinely popular movement, and anyone wanted to make a film about England has to take it into account. Jubilee is a deeply pessimistic film, but it's not unreal." So, I mean, I've only seen Jubilee once, and it's a very nihilistic film, isn't it? I think we've probably covered it in the A-Z of Punk.
Yeah, I saw it again not long after it came out, actually, so I don't remember that much about it, but I do remember not really enjoying it very much. Maybe I would enjoy it a bit more now, I don't know.
Maybe not. I mean, Maker takes, it seems to take argument with it. It calls it an irresponsible movie. Don't remember punk this way.
Right, okay.
Because of its idea. Nebworth, in the meantime, no one seems to want to headline Nebworth this year. Britain's leading outdoor rock festival in Hertfordshire is in doubt for a second year running after a weekend of disasters that included the sudden cancellation of Jefferson Starship as headline attraction.
Right.
Promoter Fred Bannister tells Melody Maker he's been facing severe problems finding top acts. "At the moment, I'm terribly pessimistic," he says. "I've approached everybody, Bob Dylan, Wings, Neil Young, the Eagles, you name them, but for various reasons, no one seems interested. Led Zeppelin, poor things, are about the only ones I haven't tried," which is ironic, isn't it? Because they people talk about Nebworth in the 70s, one memory that people have generally is Nebworth and Led Zepp a year after this.
That's right, yeah, one of the biggest gigs of the decade.
Yeah. News flashes, Buzzcocks have added the Slits as support on their forthcoming British tour, also fixed extra dates at Bristol's Tiffany's and two nights at the Mayflower in Manchester. I don't know where the Mayflower was.
The Mayflower, yeah. I went to that show anyway, or one of them, but it was where the Stuff the Superstars show. It's a famous show that had The Fall, Joy Division, Frantic Elevators, The Hamsters, The Liggers. It was an all-day event, and there was a brilliant poster for it. And I think it used to be a car auction room, but it was just a big, horrible, old, damp building, which was probably knocked down not long afterwards. Mm. But that was the Mayflower. It's going out down towards Gorton Way.
Oh, OK, right, OK. Mm. And in American news, Al Green was delightful in his two gigs at the Music Centre. The old joke was if you attended a Green show, you could leave your car running because he only did half an hour. This time he did close to an hour and the programme was devastating at times. This was the best Green gig in ages and there was an almost religious atmosphere. On stage, he practically was preaching between numbers to reach the audience. While in town, he preached at Washington Boulevard Church on Sunday morning, which is interesting because he gave it all up to join the ministry, didn't he, after a while?
He did, and I did go and see him. I'm pleased to say, tick him off the list, but I went to see Al Green playing at the Apollo, probably mentioned it before, but he, talking of, like, I don't know, his attitude towards putting the hours in,
yeah.
He spent a lot of the time handing the microphone out for other people in the audience to sing his songs. Now, he has got up there with the greatest voices ever, and you don't need to hear some Muppet behind me screaming, you know, tired of being alone for half an hour, do you?
Not at all. That kind of stretching. Who was the other person who did that? Was it Leonard Cohen? No. Did he do something else?
Leonard Cohen... The last time I saw Leonard Cohen at the Opera House, he spent half the time doffing his trilby and introducing the band time and time again. Yes, we know now, Leonard.
That's just as bad, isn't it?
Well, he wasn't great, that.
Anyway, I'm going to play this for you and Trace.
Well, thank you very much, mate. I adore this. And in fact, if I can bounce it along, I'll play it for Craig Scanlon because he introduced me to it. Once is ever, in my opinion, that is Al Green and Bell. I'm Mark Riley, that is Bobby Hughes, and we are in the parallel universe.
It's a pleasure. So we're looking at Melody Maker, 25th of February 1978. In the news, Mick Jagger now wears a codpiece on stage. Etta James, support act for some of the Stones' American dates, told the London Evening News, nobody knew it until it fell down to his ankle one night.
I'm just thinking about the poster I would have had, you know, the Rolling Stones plus support and, you know, not knowing exactly what that meant until it fell round his ankles. I wonder if that episode is a new series, isn't there, on TV at the moment about the Stones?
Oh, is there? I haven't watched it yet.
I haven't either, but I'm just wondering if that footage is in it.
I reckon
unlikely.
They probably not put that in. In the last year, Elvis has generated at least £500 million worth of business, of which 80% has been down to record sales. One of his most recent pieces of Elvis exploitation has been to sell at £3.50 an inch 2 acres of Elvis's Mississippi retreat, the Circle G Ranch. If all the land is sold, it means that 6 million people will have a share in it. Did you ever go to Graceland when you were in Memphis?
Yeah.
Yeah. Was it as impressive as you thought?
Yeah, he was mad. I mean, you know, you've seen the photographs, so you're wandering around. And we went with the Fall, but we didn't go in the house. And then I went again with John Langford and Trace and Sally Timms and Gary Held, who was the guy who brought Nirvana over to the UK. there was the guide was saying, Elvis's auntie Mimi is in this room, so if you can please be quiet, and all this kind of stuff. And somebody said, this is the bedroom where Elvis passed away.
Right.
And somebody not that far away from me, well, it wasn't me,
yeah, right.
Went, that's rubbish, he fell off the toilet, which dinkered down so well. But we did manage, on the second visit, into the TV room, you know, where with loads of different TVs and the tiger print settees and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, it was a blast going there, obviously amazing, and these cars outside and stuff.
Yeah, how wonderful. We will get to Devo. So there's pages and pages of a feature here by Ian Birch on Devo. We are the next thing. Starting with a list of guidelines, which reminds me of Eno's oblique strategies. So, for example, things like be like your ancestors or be different, grow big or stay little, win a mate by combat or not, fight your neighbours or untie them. I wonder if that's a typo. Should have been unite them. But I don't know. Anyway, the guidelines were created by Devo. It says everybody's tipping them for megastardom and rumours circulate daily about multi-million dollar contracts. They've been in existence for around 6 years, as we mentioned, holed up in America's Midwest and have produced all of 2 singles so far. So why all the furore? Quite simply, Devo are extraordinary. Sometime last year, they managed to slip Bowie a tape while he was touring in Cleveland with Iggy Pop, but he paid little mind until Iggy discovered the item during a bout of boredom. That got Bowie and, logically enough, Brian Eno involved, and all three gents offered to produce the first album. At the moment, they're in Cologne with Eno and sporadically Bowie, who's tied up in movie commitments, at the mixing desk. Bowie once described Devo as three Enos and a couple of Edgar Froses in one band from Tangerine Dream.
Right.
Which is not a bad reference point, really, is it?
For him, it's a huge compliment. I mean, Edgar Froese being of Tangerine Dream, cited really by those in the know as being the biggest influence of all with Bowie for Low and the Berlin era.
Completely. Goes into the concept of devolution, which obviously is convoluted in its way, but it's essentially taking ransacking ideas from the past, presenting them in a different way for the future. That's what they were all about, just at different angles and in different contexts.
Essentially, they were actually like all that was bubbling away years before, which we mentioned before at university. Yeah. That's when they got together, wasn't it? And started coming up with this philosophy.
Yeah, so the philosophy was first, and then, you know, the music came after. And it's easier to see why the music press went crazy over them, because there was so much to go at. There's not much recorded material so far, but as in terms of like meat and ideas and attitude, there's loads to sort of get into early on.
And not only that, but if you think about it, I mean, punk was pretty lumpen, wasn't it? I mean, some of it was so lumpen and terrible, but a lot of it was amazing. You know, we loved the Pistols and the Clash and Buzzcocks and Susie and the Banshees, that lot. But then around about this time, there was some of the more lumpen stuff coming through as well. And then you've got this uber intelligent outfit from Akron, as you say, just really like, just coming at it from a completely different angle.
Yeah, totally. On the one hand, it says they may appear perverse, but yet they have a healthy sense of humour and self-satire. Something like Captain Beefheart in his Trout Mask replica phase, which has been an undoubted influence for them. Anyway, so there's an interview down the phone from Cologne. They ask, how did the partnership come about? Jerry Casale says, we always had a desire to be produced by either Eno or Bowie, or possibly both, and there were equal choices, and it's turned out we're going to eventually have both of them. Out of anybody in the business, they were obviously the closest to the devolved end of the scale. The sounds they achieved, the way they approached the art, and in the case of David, of course, his understanding of media and total image. To be honest, there weren't that many choices.
Which
makes sense completely. So where are we going now?
Well, you're going to carry on till, until five, and we'll just play Dillinger.
Of course. So, singles, Devo gets single of the week, we've heard that. There's Kiss's Rocket Ride, mindless heavy metal, which sledgehammers every cliche in the book, coupled with crass sex and ludicrously excessive visuals. What else would you expect?
Absolutely. So, you're talking about Kiss there. The tune was called Rocket Ride, was
it? Rocket Ride.
Well, I did see them in 1975, I think it was, at the Free Trade Hall, and at one point, I think it was Gene Simmons, had a rocket in his bass and fired it into the sky. So I would imagine that was at that point in time, was
that
it?
That would have been it, I imagine so, yeah, 78. The Weirdos, Destroy All Music, The Jam, News of the World. On new albums, you've got Alan Jones reviewing Nick Lowe's Jesus of Cool. He said, this record is so fab, it hurts. Bashir's fashioned himself a masterpiece of contemporary pop, thoroughly immersed in wit, style and imagination. Jesus of Cool confirms Jake Riviera's description of Nick Lowe as the last pop genius. A wonderful album. No self-respecting teenager should be without a copy, he says.
Leafing through the Melody Maker before, I did notice that they've got two full-page adverts for Nick Lowe.
So you
open up the page and then you go, oh, right, who's that? It's not very well cut. It's not got his name written large. You've got to read it. And you go, oh, right, yeah, Nick Lowe. Right, OK. You turn the page over. Exactly the same advert again, but with some slightly different text in it. They obviously had a massive faith in him being ginormous.
Yeah, totally. And the idea was, as well, as regards to music press, is they would send music press little postcards, which were Nick Lowe dressed as a Scottish troubadour or another setting as a European sort of chanson singer all the way, and send them as a bit of a clue to where he's coming from for the album.
Well, Mischief for Go-Go, as you would expect from that lot. OK, so thanks very much to you, Bob, and to Michelle and Perfect Peter and Hobbers, and Gid is next, and we shall see you tomorrow night. And we're going to leave you now with Dillinger and Cocaine in My Brain. Thanks for listening. Take care, you lot. Bye.
Hey, Jim. Just a minute, y'all. I want you spell for me something. I want you spell for me New York, man. Why do you want to spell New York, man? I just want you spell for me New York. Can you do that, man? Sure, man, I can spell New York. We'll be right back.
Prepare to exit the parallel universe.
Marc Riley, BBC Six Music.
And shut the door on your way out.